All right, it's time to get to work. Jerk of All Trades Podcast, episode one. I'm here with Ray.
This is me. I am here with Eddie and myself.
And today we're talking about WrestleMania.
WrestleMania, the grand daddy of them all, or the ultimate thrill ride is what they're calling it this year. So
The ultimate thrill ride.
They are hammering that home at every single moment. So,
Well, we're about to hammer out this podcast.
We're going to hammer something.
Yeah, WrestleMania 33.
Can't touch us.
Is coming up next week or the week after. I'm not really sure. But we'll be giving you our predictions later on in the show, along with like a little mini breakdown. We also have top 10 lists, maybe 10, maybe 5, maybe 15. You have to
could
stay
be
tuned
every
to
match
find
ever
out.
In
yeah.
WrestleMania history, ranked top to bottom.
Down. This is gonna be the longest
top
podcast
to bottom
in the history of podcasts. This is gonna be a 9-hour podcast of WrestleMania.
Get ready, tuned. Folks.
No, but yeah, we got our favorite matches for you for WrestleMania, just as a backdrop to what's coming up later. With WrestleMania coming up, and I thought it would be a good idea to talk about, like, basically me and Ray have been friends for pretty much 15 years.
Oh, dude, your math is off. That's fuzzy math, dude.
15?
1998, so okay. It's been about 20 years, I believe.
And, you know,
almost a quarter of a century.
It's basically all been based off of wrestling.
This is true.
Yeah, so, like, how fitting is it that 20 years later, we're on your couch chilling?
Talking about wrestling
talking
for
about
our
wrestling
first
for
podcast.
First podcast. It's only right that we talk about wrestling. This isn't going to be a wrestling show. We will talk about wrestling here and there, but we figured since WrestleMania is coming up, perfect time to talk about some wrestling.
Absolutely.
So let's kick this bad boy off and talk about some WrestleMania. So, you know, WrestleMania has been going on for a long time now. 1985 was the first WrestleMania.
It's been, I believe, 33 years.
Yeah, WrestleMania.
33 years. So here's an off the script. What was the first WrestleMania that you really distinctly remember watching?
WrestleMania 1.
WrestleMania 1.
On VHS.
Just so you guys know his credentials, in case anyone wants to check his his wrestling cred card. WrestleMania 1, he was 2 years old. 2 years old.
Yes. Well, my father and grandmother had a VHS of WrestleMania 1 that I watched on repeat over and over again until I was about 5 years old. The first WrestleMania that I remember the build up to was actually WrestleMania 3. WrestleMania 3,
WrestleMania.
Andre ripping the cross off of Hogan. That really threw me through a loop when I was a kid, but it was all worth it because Hogan got the victory in the end.
Do you think that Hulk Hogan was a devout Christian back then? Or
absolutely, you can just tell by looking at him.
We know some of the struggles that Terry Bollea has had in his later years. So, latter years, as the kids call it. So, I'm not real sure. I'm not real sure where his belief system lies.
Well, as a kid, I ate him up, man. He was great.
I don't want to know what you did with your free time with Terry Bollea. So,
but hey, man, as a kid, Hulk Hogan was great.
Absolutely,
couldn't get enough. You know, great showman, great promo, or maybe not a great promo, depends on your take.
No, absolutely, absolutely. I think that if you put a list together of the top 10 promos of all time, well, not top 10 promos, but top 10 promo guys, how could Hogan not be on that list?
He's done a shitload of promos, too.
I mean,
week in and week out, he was doing promos.
I think Hulk Hogan should be on the list for the greatest wrestlers of all time, simply based on the fact that he drew more fucking money than, you know,
just about 1,000...
5,000 wrestlers combined.
5 million wrestlers combined, probably.
This is true.
So, what about you?
Actually, the first WrestleMania that I actually distinctly remember the build up to was actually WrestleMania 10. WrestleMania 10. I'm a late bloomer.
Oh, shoot. Yeah.
I had watched wrestling with my buddy in earlier years and was into the Warrior and Hogan and all that stuff, but not an every week kind of watcher. And I remember the summer of 1993, actually. It's really sad. The thing that won me over somehow, you hear all these great stories about people and, like, the moment that they saw wrestling and loved it. And, you know, it's always the the snooker with the coconut, or, you know, maybe, you know, Michael's through the barbershop window, or, you know, what you described. And, you know, mine is the Lex Express and the body slam on the USS Intrepid, which was not a good, like, I would have shit all over that. But for some reason, it clicked with me. And that summer, I just became obsessed with, like, everything that was wrestling, and couldn't get enough of it. And so going into 1994, the build-up for WrestleMania 10 at Madison Square Garden, that was the first year that I was just absolutely positively obsessed with wrestling. And I definitely had some ups and downs after that, but that was the year that I became obsessed with this bastard form of entertainment that I still hate, enjoy to this day.
Yeah, I think 93 was around the PG era before the PG era, like, or maybe not, that's a bad way to put it, but
I mean, I think the 80s was also the PG era
as well.
80s was very
PG. Yeah, 80s was very PG, but it seemed like the 90s was a different kind of PG.
Yeah, it was
early 90s.
I definitely, this era was the shitty gimmick, not 80s style, just even worse than that, just the profession era, I guess I would describe it as, you know, this guy's a plumber, this guy's a garbage man, you know, this guy works for the cable company. I don't think that was a gimmick,
yeah.
But
well, I think it was because WWE got away from the steroids, and so they had to go to a more basic kind of, instead of your warlords and your, you know, British bulldogs, you had, you know, your Duke the Dumpsters.
I mean, you still had British Bulldog at that point, I think, though.
Oh, really? Oh.
I was like 95.
I'd already fallen off the wrestling wagon by then. I was an early guy, so by the time 93 came around, I was already into the Chicago Bulls and other kind of sports and stuff.
Yeah, you know what? I fair weather liked the Bulls at that point, too.
Sure. So, yeah, I mean, so what do you think? Get to these
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to
top 10s?
Yeah, we're going to count down our top 10 favorite WrestleMania matches of all time, but we're not going to count them down. We did not number these because
no, not in any specific order,
right?
We got 10
matches that if you wanted to watch a WrestleMania, these would be matches that you would be very much looking forward to watching.
These are your matches. You pop into WrestleMania and you're just like, man, this is 3 hours. But
actually, now they're like 8 hours long.
Oh, yeah. I get 3 hours of Flo Rida and 15 minutes of John Cena, right?
I just watched, we're watching, we have a little background noise of the true story of WrestleMania, and I just watched the refrigerator just totally topple shit over the top rope and almost die, and I think a fan almost died too.
Yeah,
so
he almost beheaded himself on the bottom rope there.
Could have been a Mankind-type moment for him.
Yeah. So, you want to go ahead and kick it off?
Absolutely.
I know we're going to have some repeats, so obviously I may not have 10 matches, but I can kind of ad-lib as we go along here.
Yeah, I think we will we'll shoot a match off, and we can kind of discuss that match and, you know,
yeah,
what our
commentary on it.
Yep. All right. So the first match that I'm going to throw out there is going to be Stone Cold Steve Austin versus The Rock at WrestleMania 15.
Ooh, I thought you almost stole one of mine.
What was yours going to be the 17 match?
Mine is X7, yes. Spoiler alert.
Wait, was 17 the heel turn, or no, that was 19?
That was the heel turn.
That was 17?
Yes.
I can't do it, man. I can't do it.
But back to X5. This is we're going yours, X5. A lot of wrestling in the crowd for that match.
And keeping in mind, I actually have not gone back and watched this match.
Sure.
And I don't even know how long. I actually realized as I went through, so I basically went through a list of every single WrestleMania ever and looked through the matches and whatever stuck out to me. And there's some matches that I watch pretty regularly. This is not one of them.
Well,
but
this
is
The Rock coming off his heel turn. He was the champ going in.
And this is the height of, you know, professional wrestling
the
fandom
era.
And the...
Yeah.
The two biggest stars, and I'm sure the work rate is not up to the indie darling standards that we have these days, but you know, I would trade that off for, you know, the two hottest stars of all time.
Great era.
At WrestleMania.
Great era. I was all over The Rock at this point. I was on The Rock early.
You were on. Yeah. Always ahead of the game, man. Ahead of the curve.
I know how to pick them, you know.
Why don't you tell them one of the other things that you were ahead of the game on? He's slightly controversial. I don't know if you can say his name.
The WCW getting bought by WWE?
No, there's a particular person. He's a controversial non.
Oh, you're talking about our president of the United States.
No, we're not going down that road. Okay, he's not quite that controversial. I was actually talking about Chris Benoit. Not quite.
The man that doesn't exist.
Not quite. I wish that we could say the same about Trump, but we're not going down the political route this week. But I'm sure we will have many a discussion.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, Chris Benoit, man, he was my guy. After Bret Hart, it was definitely Chris Benoit, and then it was The Rock.
And then what year? Like 97, right?
95, probably.
95.
Or maybe no, 96, probably. 96.
Was that when he was in the Four Horsemen?
It was during the Michaels era. You know, I kind of wasn't digging the sexy boy. And went over and found Chris Benoit in WCW. It's fucking awesome.
Was he in the Four Horsemen at that point? Or
most likely, yeah. Most likely, yeah. But
anyway, all right.
Anyways,
back on track.
Back to your list. We have what else do we have?
All right, so that was The Rock versus Stone Cold. I definitely will need to go back and watch that match, but I had to put that on the list. I thought that was a solid choice. Do you want me to go through all of my list?
Oh yeah, let me give you one of mine so we can rotate. We can go back and forth.
That makes sense.
I have easily one of the best matches ever. I'm starting from the bottom here because after WrestleMania 25, I didn't have any matches to put on my list because I haven't seen too many WrestleManias after WrestleMania 25. I have Shawn Michaels versus The Undertaker, WrestleMania 25.
You have actually stolen my my number one pick
this
here.
This is everyone's
pick. I think if you are a professional wrestling fan, there's no way that this match cannot be your best match of WrestleMania ever.
Obviously, I don't watch wrestling that much anymore, but I am fairly confident in saying that this is probably the best match I have ever seen.
No doubt.
And I have seen thousands of wrestling matches. Thousands and thousands of wrestling matches. The best match I've ever seen by far.
I mean, as a professional wrestler, I mean, you have to want just a fraction of the amount of tension and drama and in-ring, you know, psychology, work rate, like everything that should all be combined that you don't get and sometimes you accept as a great match because it only has one of those things. This match has all of those things and it has them better than any match ever. It honestly does not get any better than this match. And I will say too that I actually was not even watching wrestling at this point. I gave up wrestling for probably about maybe 5 to 6 years or so, due to some life changes and also because of Eugene and ECW being bastardized. But I actually wasn't even watching the build up to this match, and I don't think that it hindered this match whatsoever. And it's at my number one, you know, best WrestleMania match and possibly best match I've ever seen.
Shawn Michaels versus The Undertaker, WrestleMania 25. Even if you don't watch wrestling, give it a look. It's probably on YouTube. It's a little bit long, but it's every step of the way. It's fantastic. Great, 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 great match.
Absolutely.
All right, Ray, what do you got?
All right. Let's throw out Macho Man Randy Savage versus, who am I going to say?
Probably my pick, The Ultimate Warrior.
The Ultimate Warrior at WrestleMania 7.
Great pick.
I think that many, many people would have expected to see Ricky Steamboat on here. Absolutely, it's a great match. But Warrior versus Macho Man Randy Savage. What a tremendous match. Huge, huge stakes with that match. The whole storyline with Miss Elizabeth. Just honestly, I mean, it's crazy to put The Ultimate Warrior in a top 10 anything that isn't batshit fucking crazy promos list, or man, that's really weird he died list.
Well,
but
obviously, or maybe not so obviously, depends on your taste, but for me, clearly the best Ultimate Warrior match,
not even close,
of all time. The drama going in, not so high. I didn't feel it as a kid, but the drama during the match, commentary on the match.
Perfect. Absolutely.
Great. I mean, I'm going to repeat all my adverbs and adjectives here. Great. Fantastic. You know, it's just like
phenomenal. Would you say it was phenomenal?
Copyright
AJ Styles.
Just, and the drama is second to none. Great pick. Ultimate Warrior versus Macho Man, WrestleMania 7. You know, it catches you. It catches you off guard, even if you're not really a fan.
Yeah, you know what? So prior to my like obsessive fandom, you know, I was a pro wrestling fan. I watched my best friend growing up. His name was Andy, and we would hang out and we would watch wrestling together. And I remember I had an Ultimate Warrior like pillow thing, and so. I liked wrestling, but I wasn't watching it religiously, and so I didn't watch the build-up to this WrestleMania, but definitely did not hurt that match. Like Eddie said, the commentary put it over, and I think that's something that's really important.
The rewatchability is very high, and I do believe, I may be mistaken, this is the first WrestleMania where finishers got kicked out of.
Really? I would be very, very interested to go back and see that.
The finishers got kicked out of in this match.
I cannot think of a time prior to that.
Not multiple times, but it was like, whoa, he kicked out of the elbow.
Finisher mania, yeah. That has become a bit of a thing. So
10 finishers before the match is over.
That would be something interesting to go back to and check out.
All right, so that, yeah, great match, WrestleMania 7, Macho Man and Warrior. Let me go to my list here. I'm just working from the bottom here, bottom to the top. Undertaker versus Randy Orton.
Interesting.
Let me explain.
what WrestleMania was the set?
This was WrestleMania 21, WrestleMania Goes Hollywood.
I barely remember this match, I have to be honest. No. I thought that I was starting to mistake this with the Triple H match where they fought out in the crowd pretty significantly. That was like right around that time. Was he American Badass Undertaker at this point? Or
No. He was SmackDown Undertaker.
Is this Streak? Is this Legend Killer Randy Orton?
This is early era? Legend Killer. Okay. This was the first WrestleMania where I thought maybe there's a chance.
I think that
Undertaker might lose.
I think that at the time, I think that the Undertaker did want to lose a streak to Randy Orton. I think I did
really?
Hear that.
Oh,
and for whatever reason, that did not happen. I do remember this. What year was this? Maybe 2006?
2005.
So this is starting to go into the dark period for me. So I don't
remember.
Not the
greatest match of all time, but a very good match. Very good drama. A lot of false finishes, as us wrestling fans like to say. It will hook you. It will definitely hook you. And at the time, you know, the streak was on the line. Orton was coming up. And Orton was hot, man. Orton was, he was on the rise. But, you know, didn't happen.
No, it did not. I was actually, a few years ago, I went back and I was watching every streak match all the way through. So I did watch this match maybe 3 years ago or so. So I don't vividly remember it, but I do remember it. And, yeah, I think this was definitely when Undertaker started to get into the groove of better matches at WrestleMania.
Yeah, oh yeah, certainly, definitely. All right, what do you got?
All right, my next pick, this was a tough one because I was really trying to rack my brain and differentiate each one of these matches because there was, I think, at least four or five years in a row. But I picked the Money in the Bank match from WrestleMania 24, which was the first year that CM Punk won. And the reason why I picked that is this is once again when I was not watching pretty regularly. And so I knew CM Punk from kind of earlier days. I had seen him in Windy City Wrestling, you know, to be the smarky, you know, I knew him by his old name kind of fan. But it was interesting I thought the match was awesome, and it was really cool and unexpected that CM Punk won because I didn't know what was going on with him, and I didn't know if he was getting pushed or buried or what. So I definitely enjoyed this match, and I believe this was an outside WrestleMania too, which I always liked.
Yeah, you know what? The whole time you were explaining it, I was thinking of the one he won the second time. Mm-mm. But I do remember this one. It was a surprise for him to win. Money in the Bank matches are usually a crapshoot. As far as predictions
yeah.
go, it's really
this was early on. I think this was only this may have been the second or possibly third Money in the Bank. It was still pretty early on.
It was still early, and there were so many guys that could have won.
Yeah.
That could have won that match. I remember Jericho was in there.
And I think Shelton Benjamin was, like, Shelton in Benjamin. His, like, you know, when he was real hype and doing his high spots and stuff in the Money in the Bank.
But, yeah, you can't go wrong with a Money in the Bank match because you know you're going to see some crazy shit.
Absolutely. And this was, you know, this is in that early, like, this is kind of the, you know, like, the early TLC matches, you know, like, where they didn't just constantly have to, like, live up to some sort of certain expectation that they probably couldn't do and, you know, people are potentially getting hurt. This is kind of a back burner kind of pick that I decided to throw out there. So
sure, I've saved my back burners. I didn't want to get too boring before we got to the you know crazy goofball picks of mine.
The meat and potatoes. Oh, you got some goofy picks.
I've got some goofy.
I did
ones.
Not. Man, I should have.
Well, I mean,
we should have pre-discussed this.
That's
because
just my style.
That's all right.
But I do have some big ones. My next pick is from WrestleMania 19. Probably the most obvious pick of WrestleMania 19, probably on your list. Shawn Michaels versus Chris Jericho.
No, actually not on my list. I actually, so there was, I will be honest, there was multiple matches as I scrolled through and I thought, man, this match was probably amazing, but I just haven't watched it in so long that I can't comment in, you know, say that it really was,
you know,
as good as it was.
The good thing is for me, I haven't watched any new WrestleMania stuff, so everything that I have backlogged in my mind kind of just sits there. So it was really easy for me to come up with this list because I don't have a lot of new stuff clogging up my.
You know, it's actually funny.
Archive.
So my not to reveal too much, but my list does not have a WrestleMania match in the past 5 years. I do not have a WrestleMania match.
Yeah.
Not one single one. I had a couple that I considered, but I do not have one from the past 5 years.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, Shawn Michaels, Chris Jericho. WrestleMania X9 was really good, just my point of view. There were some really good matches on there. But Shawn Michaels and Chris Jericho tore the house down. They just tore it down, man. They just almost a flawless match. I obviously haven't seen it probably in about 6 or 7 years, but you got two guys that can bust their ass, that can do a little high flying, that can work the crowd, and you know, it was the perfect.
Both still in a good place in their career as well.
Oh,
you know,
sure.
Jericho in probably his prime at that point.
Michaels just had a 4-year break. You know, he's ready to come back and prove that he was still the showstopper and everything else. And Jericho, who was coming off his WrestleMania X8. Match with Triple H, didn't get all the fanfare in the world because of another match on that card, showed that, you know, he was somebody to watch too within the company.
Absolutely.
So yeah, if you get a chance, you enjoy wrestling, Shawn Michaels versus Chris Jericho, WrestleMania X9, WrestleMania 19.
Absolutely. Amazing match, no doubt. All right. My next pick I'm going to go for is this will be interesting to see what your reaction is, because I don't think you like this match as much as I do, but I think many others will. Shawn Michaels versus Razor Ramon from WrestleMania 10, the ladder match.
Yeah, I haven't seen it in a while, but man, Razor Ramon, oof, he took some sick ladder bumps on that in that match. He took an ass kicking in that match.
I think, you know, you have to, I think one of the big things too, it would be tough for someone maybe to go back and watch it now and be as impressed with it, because the high spots are nowhere near what they are now, but
it was the original kind of like Daredevil match, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, you see Scott Hall now and he can barely walk. He's like shuffling his feet.
He's doing better now. Yeah. He's doing he's on the DDP yoga.
Oh, good.
Thing, and
yeah,
he's actually doing
awesome.
A lot better.
Well, it's because of that match, though.
I'm sure that was part of it. I'm sure that, you know, rampant alcoholism and drug use and steroid use probably didn't help things, but ladder bumps at WrestleMania 10 also didn't help.
I can think of at least 2 or 3 times where Michaels just laid into him with that ladder right on his back, and it was just like, oh, you got to be kidding me, man. But, yeah, I mean, I don't remember too much about that match. I've only seen it a handful of times, maybe less.
You always got to remember the splash off the top. They're at MSG, too, so I mean, that's always amazing. You know what? Actually, this is a real quick off the cuff little comment, but I just read that. So apparently, when you run a show at Madison Square Garden, you have to use all people that they approve that are part of the unions in New York, and because of all the crazy mobbed out rules that probably exist there. I don't know if that's true or not, but apparently every WrestleMania that they've ever run there, they've actually lost money. Even WrestleMania 20, up to WrestleMania 20, they lost money running there because they had to pay these people so much to do every little minutia that they can normally bring their own people in. So WrestleMania will actually never probably be at Madison Square Garden again because of that.
Yeah.
Also because they don't.
New York is such a great market, and I love watching Raw from New York.
Yeah.
You know, pay-per-views from New York, especially the Garden. It's such a special.
It's awesome. But and I mean the fact that it doesn't house, you know, 90,000 people, but
yeah. It's still the Garden though.
And, absolutely.
You know, it's like as an old school guy, I can appreciate cuz WrestleMania 1 and 2 emulated from Madison Square Garden. But
Donald Trump is actually coming, walking to the ring in the background, and
the Trumpster,
and I'm flipping him off while.
Oh, I thought you were giving him a thumbs up.
While Eddie is giving him the thumbs up.
Oh,
so.
My bad. I thought you were digging it.
That's anyway.
You got for Razor and Sean?
Yeah, just an awesome match for its time. At that time, I was a huge, huge mark for Razor Ramon, big, big fan. And, yeah, Shawn Michaels, I was becoming a fan of as well. He was heel at that point, but was definitely starting to enjoy his work more. But, yeah, I was a huge, huge Razor Ramon mark. I was a big, big fan of him, and he definitely had something different going on than a lot of the other guys did. So, and just a very different match for the time. At that point, I had never really seen anything quite like that. So
the dual Intercontinental.
Yeah.
Two belts, I believe.
Two belts. Yeah, certainly not the first time they've done a two belt kind of thing, but you know.
Yeah, it was cool.
Yeah.
All right. Well, next on my list is probably my favorite match in WrestleMania history. I've seen it so many times. I could probably have the match with you right now and have it move by move. Rock versus Hogan, WrestleMania X8.
This was actually this was on my list as well. So. I'm glad that you said that, because I have a backup match for that match. But yeah, man, how could this not be on anyone's list? I mean, you have the two of the biggest superstars of all time facing off WrestleMania, and the interesting crowd dichotomy.
The crowd was so into it. You will 99% not see a crowd this into a match as you've seen at you will never see a crowd as into a match as they were into Rock Hogan. The closest thing I can think of is the CM Punk in Chicago match. But it was all for Hogan. It was Hogan's first big pay-per-view match since leaving WWF the first time. And the fans couldn't wait to cheer him. They just couldn't wait to cheer him.
Mind you, he was a bad guy. He was a heel.
It kind of stems too, because like The Rock, the WrestleMania before that, got booed at X7 when he wrestled Austin. So
was he a heel at that point?
No, he was always a babyface, and he got booed again.
You don't realize as Hogan. You do not realize as you go back that The Rock kind of had that John Cena effect too.
He had the Cena heat.
Stone Cold is the last babyface that truly
got cheered.
The fans just obsessively. I mean,
still waiting for John Cena to get cheered at WrestleMania. It's gotta never happen eventually.
Like we talked about this before. I just don't ever see it happening.
It's become
a thing for him to get booed, and even if people respect him and like his work now, he's still not going to get cheered.
Poor John Cena, man. If anybody deserves it, it's fucking him.
Absolutely. It's fucking him.
But I'm sorry. Anyways. So, yeah, Rock Hogan, WrestleMania X8. It was Hogan's first match back. Not the most, you know, scientific of wrestling matches. But, you know, the crowd reaction to the match makes it all worth it.
I mean, I think that really speaks to, you know, I talk with, you know, a lot of younger fans that, you know, may have a different perspective, or, you know, they, you know, grew up watching a different, you know, product than I did. And, you know, so they, you know, see things a little bit differently than I do. But I would trade this type of crowd and this type of response and heat for whatever is happening to two guys that the fans could not give a single shit about doing a bunch of flips. We were watching The Rock versus Mankind in an empty arena match from, 99?
Halftime Heat.
And that was, what pay-per-view had we just watched? Fastlane or, no, not Fastlane.
Oh, I think Royal Rumble.
And my comment was that the empty arena match was actually getting a better reaction than whatever the cruiserweight match was that was on the Royal Rumble, and it actually wasn't a far cry. And those guys were probably fucking killing themselves, and I'm sure that, you know, they're going to be doing the next generation DDP yoga in like 20 years or 15 years, and nobody will have, no one will have cared, and, you know, that's sad. So I love this match. It's amazing, amazing.
Such a different era. All right, what do you got, boss?
One other comment I wanted to make on that, I thought would be interesting for you maybe to comment. So the last time as well that Hulk Hogan was at WrestleMania in Toronto was when he lost to the Ultimate Warrior. Was that correct?
Yes.
So this was like an interesting little kind of...
Canada loves Hogan.
This is a chance for him to kind of redeem himself and, get that back. And so it's interesting that Canada loves Hulk Hogan and Hulk Hogan hates Bret Hart, so...
And Hulk Hogan's the American hero, not the Canadian hero.
Yeah, this is true.
It is very interesting when you break it all down. But he stands for what a lot of Canada stands for, you know, the always being truthful and honest and representing, like, the goodness and everything. Like,
except when you're making racist comments
this was
boned your...
I'm talking about WrestleMania
6. Sorry.
WrestleMania 6.
We're talking Hulk Hogan in character.
Yeah. Okay. The character of Hulk Hogan is basically Canada.
Okay.
You know, the altruism.
Blame Canada. Blame Canada for Hulk Hogan.
They're good people.
You heard it here first.
They're good people to a fault. But that's all right. But anyways, next on the list...
All right. The next thing on my list is going to be... Now, this is actually a kind of interesting pick, and I can't imagine that many people will put this on their list, but this was once again an era when I was not watching, so I did not see the build-up to it, but a match that in hindsight and when I've gone back that I've just absolutely adored is Vince McMahon versus Hulk Hogan from WrestleMania 19.
Ooh, I thought you were going Vince versus Shane for a second there.
No.
Vince and Hogan. 19, right?
Vince and Hogan, WrestleMania 19.
That was pretty good.
And the reason why I like this is, so obviously I grew up on the WWF production value and, you know, what Vince's idea is. And this match has that in spades. You know, you can just see Vince's fingerprints all over this match.
Oh, yeah.
There's what I think to just be one of the ultimate great visual moments in WWE history where Vince McMahon is just a bloodied mess, and the camera is just fixed on where Vince McMahon is down by the ring apron, and he just lifts his head up, just an absolute bloodied mess with just this maniacal look on his face. And those are things that you don't see enough, I feel. And this match just had many of those moments, and it was just an absolute bloodbath for... You would never expect Vince McMahon versus Hulk Hogan to be this... a wild of match, and in this day and age it would be just abysmal, but somehow it just landed in the right time and it had the story behind it, and so
it worked for those guys. Yeah, obviously not the best wrestlers, clearly one of Vince's best matches.
I mean, name
probably
name
his best match.
Name another good Vince McMahon match.
You know, so it worked. It all worked. Love.
Maybe subliminal messages, maybe playing some records backwards. You never know.
So. Eddie had to take a pee-pee, but we're back.
There is room. Sorry.
Okay, Ozzy.
I'll re-edit that in editing post-production thing.
Sweet.
Stuff.
All right. So, yeah, we had WrestleMania X9, Vince versus Hogan. Next on my list was the Austin versus Rock, WrestleMania X7. This was really hard because when I got to WrestleMania X7, there was like three or four matches where I was like, they could easily go on the list. WrestleMania X7 in my
were opinion, any of them Hulk Hogan versus Vince McMahon?
No, or, X7.
Oh, X7. Sorry. Apparently, none of them were, obviously.
No, absolutely not, Ray. Horrible pick.
What other matches would
the matches I enjoyed without looking at the list offhand is the Raven versus Big Show versus Rhino.
Raven versus Big Show versus Kane. Wow,
that was gonna go on my list.
I almost put that on my list just because that was the only Raven WrestleMania match.
Yeah, I was very entertained by that match. Not the best match ever, but very entertaining.
The golf cart, the only introduction of a golf cart in a WrestleMania match ever.
Yeah, I was also gonna go TLC 2 with the triple threat TLC ladder match. Tag team ladder match, Edge and Christian Dudley's versus.
You know what? I can't believe that I did not put that on my list. Somehow I skipped past that when I went through the. Oh man, that was.
This should actually be in place of Austin Rock, most likely. But
I'm shocked that I did not put that on my list. But you know what?
Shane versus Vince. Wasn't bad.
I honestly don't remember Shane when you mentioned it earlier.
It's the ultimate Monday Night Raw match. Like it's got all the elements of drama and not so much wrestling. But yeah, Austin Rock, Houston, Texas, or was it in Houston? Yeah, it was in Houston. The Reliant.
It was. Yes, it was. 67,925 were there.
The Rock was the champ again.
Snickers was actually the sponsor. So
nice.
In case you're hungry.
Hey,
you know.
In case Snickers wants to sponsor us, we're here, buddy.
Yes, please.
Yeah, The Rock was the champ. Austin was the challenger. This was before Rock was going to go do movies and stuff, but wasn't really abundantly known that he would become the biggest movie star, you know, that we have nowadays.
The biggest movie star the side of Tom Cruise.
I'm not big into movies, but that's what they tell me.
The kids, is that what the kids tell you?
That's what the chicks all,
you know, what the
chicks dig the Rock.
What the ladies like to talk about.
Yeah, I can't hate them. Like I like the Rock too, way back in the day. So you know, no homo, obviously. But anyways, great match, good wrestling, good brawling, and there was a swerve at the end that kind of puts a damper on this match. But
that's why I did not put this. This is why I did not put this match on my list, because I really do think that it overshadows the match, mm-hmm. because the fans just did not like that at all.
But up until that point, the crowd couldn't have been any hotter. It was very Rock Hogan-esque.
Once again, height of pro wrestling, you could not have had a better.
It was very Rock Hogan-esque.
Main event.
The crowd was hot.
Why did they
10 out of 10 fan reaction?
Why did they feel like they had turned Stone Cold heel at this point?
I don't know, but honestly, WrestleMania X7 is great. You can watch the whole thing. You know, you can skip through a few ones, but probably pound for pound, WrestleMania X7, one of the best WrestleManias that you can watch.
Yeah, you know what? I certainly cannot disagree with that
at
all.
You got Austin Rock in the main event. You got Triple H, Undertaker. In the co-main event, as they would say in the UFC, you got Edge and you got the TLC ladder match,
which I wish I would have put on my list.
And you got the Raven hardcore match. There's Jericho versus Regal on there. There's a bunch of good matches on that card, but that's my pick, Austin Rock. Even with the shitty swerve, crowd reaction second to none, and you know. That's my pick, and I stand by it.
I am, you know what, I have to say I'm impressed, and I'm almost disappointed in myself as a you know, Raven Mark of 20 years to have not put his only WrestleMania match.
Well, you could have ad-libbed it.
Well, you know,
we could
always edit this out, but
he didn't mean to say that, Raven. He had you on the list the whole time.
You know what, hey, Raven Effect Podcast 1, if you guys want to sponsor us, you know, you sponsor us, we'll sponsor you.
Yeah, they're definitely getting the better end of that deal.
there is no goddamn doubt about it.
Yes, sir. All right, Ray, what you got?
All right. Next up on the list is we actually recently watched this match, and I don't know that you liked it as much as I did, but Stone Cold Steve Austin versus Bret Hart from WrestleMania 13, a WrestleMania that I wish I would have gone to.
Man.
But yeah, that's my pick. The only double turn that actually worked perfectly on a large scale, probably in the history of at least the WWF.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. This might be the best double turn in the history of wrestling.
I cannot think of a better one. And it will never happen again because the fans.
Especially what it did for Stone Cold Steve Austin.
He became the biggest star.
Pad to become like the greatest superstar.
We should have Bret Hart on the show at some point to talk about how bitter he is that he birthed.
How dare you?
Bret has come a little bitter in his later years, but you know what? I love Bret Hart. He's after the Ultimate Warrior, when I became obsessed again, Bret Hart was my favorite wrestler and was for a very long time, probably until he went to WCW. So
yeah, it was a very strange period of time in wrestling. You had the WCW WWE thing going on, the Monday Night Wars. Bret clearly on his way out, and Vince trying to make a new star. A lot of wrestling in the crowd for me in this match, but that's okay. The drama in this match was great. Once they finally made it back to the ring, you know, the Stone Cold bleeding in the sharpshooter, fucking fantastic.
I almost wish Ken Shamrock was not the guest referee in this match.
At the time, it worked.
I guess in context, it was okay, and like the after thing when he like went back and like he was attacking him more, it worked out all right. But I wasn't the hugest fan of what Ken Shamrock brought to this match, but
Stone Cold's entrance, that was back when they didn't do all the special.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, was that the glass breaking for the first time?
That was super cool.
That was definitely
stuff ain't special anymore because everybody gets the fancy.
Right, but the the fancy entrances are actually pretty terrible and cringe-inducing. You hope that no one walks in while you're watching it because.
Yeah,
well, be judged.
You know, it's like if everybody's special, nobody's special type of thing, right?
No, absolutely, absolutely. So, we're all special needs at some point in our life, so.
Yeah, all right.
Moving on, next pick, next what do you got?
WrestleMania 10, first match on the card. Couple of curtain jerkers, Bret versus Owen.
Oh, you know what? Actually, this, I cannot believe, once again, I'm going to say this again. I actually was about to write this on my list, and I don't know how I did not actually write it on my list because in my head.
You didn't have this on your list?
This was on my list.
This was on, yeah, this is
right.
On your.
Well, this was on the list, but this was not written on the notepad list that I had written, if that makes sense.
I got you.
So, like, I was going through the list, and somehow I managed to not actually. I think this was just so much of a given that once I thought of it, I didn't even feel like I needed to actually.
You were gonna
actually write the words down onto the iPhone notepad, but yeah, absolutely, fucking Bret versus Owen, like what an incredibly, incredibly awesome match, and how cool that, you know, even man, I was the biggest Bret Hart mark at this point, and it blew my mind when Owen won this match, but how cool that Owen got to win this match and in the fashion that he did.
I think it blew everybody's mind. Yeah. I didn't see this WrestleMania live. You know, I was kind of out of it for wrestling at this period of time. When my friends told me that Owen Hart won, I didn't believe them. I was just like, yeah, right. You fucking liars. And it was legit. He beat, and he didn't even cheat to win.
No, just, no. He got the, yeah. The victory roll, which you do not see the victory roll utilized these days. Another thing that I sorely miss.
I had to tune into WWE LiveWire to make sure that they were fucking lying to me.
Todd Pettengill Doc Hendricks.
I had to sit through an hour of that shit just to get the results of the fucking. You know how they show the stills of like WrestleMania? They couldn't show the video, but they would show the stills.
What a different era now. It's so interesting, like that you would have to like tune in to, you know, the show
6 days
to find out what happened.
When now I could just download it like the next day. The whole WrestleMania.
You could download it like, you know, an hour after the show, and if it's not online, you know, I'm pretty pissed off about it.
It'll probably be on YouTube.
So what was the context? I actually don't even remember. So Owen beat Bret, but somehow Bret ended up in the main event still.
Yeah, they had that coin toss with Lex Luger and Bret Hart to see who would face Yokozuna first.
Yeah.
But anyways, great match, Bret versus Owen, in the same cloth of the Shawn Michaels Chris Jericho match. If you enjoy wrestling, it's as close to a real wrestling match as you're gonna get. There's not a lot of fluff. There's not a lot of brawling. It's just a great, great, great wrestling match. And if you enjoy wrestling, this is your match.
No doubt. You know, both men at their absolute height. And I'm sure that, you know, after what happened, that Bret must, this must be, you know, one of Bret's favorite matches of all time. I know that he's said that him versus Benoit on Monday Nitro is actually quite possibly his favorite match of all time.
Oh, really?
I think he may have possibly said that prior to the event that will not be named, you know, with that woman and that child and stuff. But,
yeah,
you know, somber note. But, this has got to be one of Bret Hart's absolute favorite matches of all time. How could it not be?
One of mine.
Yeah, absolutely.
What do you got, Ray?
All right, my next pick is Kurt Angle versus Brock Lesnar from WrestleMania 19. Only dampered.
Two WrestleMania 19s.
Only slightly dampered. This was, in fact, WrestleMania 19, was it not? I just want to make sure. Okay. Only slightly dampered by the botched finish of Brock Lesnar attempting to do a shooting star press that didn't really work out all that well for him. And luckily, he did not end up drazed. So,
yeah.
But just a tremendous match. Brock Lesnar just awesome in this match. And Kurt Angle, man, can Kurt Angle have a bad match? I don't think that he can. I think that he's got that Shawn Michaels effect, that Jericho effect, where it's like, all right, this person versus, you know, Kurt Angle, best match I've ever had. This person versus HBK, best match I've ever had. Like, just, Angle is just...
impossible to have a bad match.
Seriously, Kurt Angle, and just crazy, you know, later on hearing about Kurt Angle and the... mental and physical state that he was in while he was in WWF, that he was able to have these level of amazing matches. I remember hearing that in his match with Shawn Michaels at WrestleMania that he was just absolutely just pilled out of his head and somehow managed to still have a great match with him.
I almost put that match on my list.
I consider putting that match on there. That was another one where it's like, I know damn good and well that this is an amazing match, but I just don't remember it well enough. But yeah, Kurt Angle was, he had a very, very, very nasty pain pill addiction at that point, and it was starting to come to light, but yet he still managed to go out and, like, just have awesome matches every single week. So, but yeah, this is just an awesome WrestleMania match, and I would love to see Kurt Angle versus Brock Lesnar again. I think that they could definitely have a great match still to this day.
If I'm Kurt Angle, I'm staying far away from Brock Lesnar.
Yeah. You know what?
With
actually,
neck and that condition.
Yeah. All right. So,
give me Lance Storm. Give me somebody light that's not going to kill me. Shawn Michaels. You know, Brock. No. Sorry.
Spot number one, German suplex. Spot number two, German suplex on your neck.
There's a reason why Rob Van Dam was the first guy to have a program of Brock Lesnar out of OVW. It's because he was tough enough to take it.
Yes.
He was tough enough to take it night in and night out.
So. RVD is a bona fide badass, and if you don't believe it, he will ask you to pick a hand.
Absolutely, and you better not pick a fucking hand. You better turn around and run away if you know what's good for you.
You hear us, Taz. Taz, we know about Taz Show. Hey, if you guys want to sponsor us, let
Taz
us know,
Show.
Man. Hit
hey,
us up.
Taz Show, what
hit
up?
Us up.
Hey, hell yeah.
Hey, we love you.
All right, so I'm going to cheat here a little bit. I have two. Because it's on the same WrestleMania.
All right, that's definitely cheating, but we'll
one of them
you...
is a great match, and one of them is a great moment. Initially, I just had Taker versus Jake Mania 8.
It's interesting.
It's the tombstone on the floor.
Okay, yeah.
Marked out so huge for that, huge, because like, you know, that was a big deal back then.
That was way prior to the good Undertaker WrestleMania matches. So. We had
it
many.
It wasn't terrible, but just the fact that he tombstone.
Hey, it wasn't Undertaker versus Giant Gonzalez. So.
No, it wasn't that bad.
No, it wasn't that good. Oh, I thought we were talking about good Undertaker matches.
No. It wasn't a great Undertaker match. It's just the moment that he tombstoned him on the concrete floor was just like something that stands out for me.
Especially for the time too. Absolutely, yeah. Like you did not
like
see.
That didn't happen.
You did not see things like that.
So, but the cream of the crop for that card was Roddy Piper versus Bret Hart.
Roddy Piper,
Intercontinental title.
You know what? Actually, that is another match that somehow I skimmed past, and I should put on the list because that was an amazing match.
This
no doubt.
This ranks up there with one of the best matches on my list. It's up there with Bret and Owen. It's up there with Michaels and Jericho. Taker and Michaels. The drama that built from the color from that match was outstanding. There was two baby faces in that match, which is extremely hard to get good drama.
Absolutely.
With two baby faces. And they had a great promo before the match that I could watch 100 times.
And a tremendous finish too.
The finish was excellent.
A great finish. Yeah. The puts him in
the reversal.
Yep. And then reversal of his finish.
Piper had the sleeper hold. That was his finisher.
Yep.
And Bret
up onto the turnbuckles roll back and absolutely another match that somehow I scrolled past. As I was going through the early WrestleManias, it was kind of tough because I didn't want to overload my list with early
everything,
stuff.
Yeah.
And then once I got to like WrestleMania like 27, 28, I started, I was skimming the bottom of the barrel to try to find something.
Yeah,
so
to fizzle out a little bit. I know the feeling. I barely even remember half of those matches after that. But
great match, great pick. Absolutely, man.
Thanks.
All right.
Watch it. Piper Hart. Excellent.
Piper versus Bret Hart. Just awesome match.
Peter
you need to
Parker
watch it.
Picked
all right. My next pick. I'm actually surprised it's not on your list, and maybe it is. But Bret Hart versus Shawn Michaels Iron Man match, WrestleMania 12.
You're surprised that's not.
Are you booing this simply because of the finish? You can't appreciate
Gorilla Monsoon coming out there strutting his stuff, ruining the whole damn thing.
You will like the decisions that Gorilla Monsoon makes, and you will not argue with them. I want to real quick. I recently went to WWE Fastlane pay per view, and someone had a sign that said "Jack Tunney is my president." And the production guys had actually taken it from him. They had been instructed by, we can only seemingly imagine that it was Vince McMahon that told them to take that sign. But I really, I appreciated that sign because, you know what? If you want to make the WWE great again, there's only one way, and that's Jack Tunney. So.
Yeah, and in a weird sort of way, Jack Tunney still is my president.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. We should make some red hats with some sort of slogan on them, and maybe we'll be able to start some sort of revolution.
I'll get right on that.
Okay. All right.
What match are we on?
I believe we're actually talking about the Iron Man match.
Okay,
so,
okay.
You know, I'll take it. Just so at this point, you know, for me, this was once again like starting to get into my peak, you know, of loving professional wrestling. And I loved Bret Hart. He was my absolute favorite wrestler. And Shawn Michaels was definitely coming up. And I thought they had a good build-up, a good story. Jose Lothario was there for, you know, weird reasons. And, I mean, a one-hour match at WrestleMania is, you know, the show's 8 hours now and you will not see an Iron Man match. They are not putting two people out there for 1 hour.
The whole show is an Iron Man match.
To be fair, there wasn't a lot else on this card to give a shit about, so it made sense to make this be 1 hour of the show. But just what a tremendous match. So many different spots and moves that you just do not see out of these two individuals just because they had to fill an hour. But it wasn't just, you know, a spot fest the whole time. I mean, you got Bret Hart in there. He's a ring general. He can, you know, bring the pace up, down, left, right, and he definitely did that. And I thought the finish was what it needed to be. And I think that, you know, Shawn Michaels needed to win the belt at that point. And obviously, in retrospect, seeing Shawn Michaels and how big of a star he ended up being, it made sense to put the belt on him at that point. And then he lost a smile and, you know, all that jazz. But
I'll give you my take on it. Like, it was unprecedented for a match to be 1 hour. I had seen Iron Man matches in WCW.
The Broadway,
yes. In WCW, they had 30-minute Iron Man matches, but not a 60-minute Iron Man match. So that was a big deal going into it. My buddy's dad actually called Shawn Michaels winning this match the whole way, and I didn't see it, like, because obviously I was a huge Bret Hart mark, so kind of pissed me off that he was right and got to gloat all about it after it was over with. But, yeah, I mean, a pretty good match. An hour is tough to keep people, you know, entertained. For
The crowd is actually not as hype as you would hope that they are in this match.
It's an hour match. It's tough, man.
And where were they?
Without any run-ins, no weapons, no brawling. No, they're not in the crowd. They got, you know, there's nothing extra. It's just those two guys for an hour. It's tough.
Where were they? Anaheim?
Yeah.
Anaheim. Okay.
So, really good match. Just not on my list. I can see why Michaels won. I'm assuming Bret Hart needed a break. He needed some time off. So.
Yeah, you could watch Wrestling with Shadows, and that might be prior to that, but yeah.
I don't know the whole backstory, but pretty good pick. Pretty good pick. Not on my list, but good pick. So I think I only have one left because you took my.
I only have one left after
this.
And
this is my curviest of curveballs.
Give it to me.
Demolition versus the Colossal Connection at WrestleMania 6. I almost went with Hart Foundation versus Nasty Boys at WrestleMania 7. WrestleMania 7, by the way, just to throw this in there, great WrestleMania. You had the Rockers versus Haku and the Barbarian. Hogan versus Slaughter. Warrior versus Savage. It's right up there at WrestleMania X7, WrestleMania X9 as some of my favorite WrestleManias. WrestleMania 7, pound for pound, one of the best WrestleManias.
You are a fan of the Slaughter-Hogan...
The time it was huge. Yeah, Hogan represented America and Slaughter represented Iraq.
Although they were like going to run a much larger arena at the time, and they supposedly got a bomb threat over Sergeant Slaughter, aka they weren't selling anywhere near the amount of tickets that they thought they were going to, so they had to move it to a smaller arena. But
yeah,
I think that was on the downturn too, though, wasn't it? What was that, 91?
Yeah, but still great WrestleMania. Great WrestleMania. It's really long too, but it keeps you entertained the whole time.
How long is that WrestleMania?
I think it's close to 4 hours.
Oh, really?
For back then, that was pretty good. But anyways, Demolition versus Colossal Connection is WrestleMania 6, actually, in the Toronto Sky Dome.
Yeah.
Crowd was hyped for that match, man. Holy cow! Didn't see it coming. I remember the build up for it. Like, I think it was on like Superstars or Wrestling Challenge or something like that, the Sunday show, where. Colossal Connection, Haku, and Andre the Giant beat Demolition for the tag titles. So Demolition was actually the challengers.
Was Andre the Giant, were they baby faces at this point? Or what was Demolition? Was
they're part of the Heenan family.
Oh, okay.
Demolition was the baby faces.
Really? Demolition was baby faces? I really don't.
Oh, big time.
I do not remember that.
We can watch this after we record.
I was not.
The crowd gets so into it. Like, I was, under the influence one time watching this WrestleMania.
We do not support altering one's perception with any sort of illegal substances here on Jerk of All Trades. If you would like to do something that is legal by the United States government or whatever governing body of whatever state or country you live in, we are okay with that. But anything illegal, we do not support that. We want to make that perfectly, perfectly clear to Mr. Donald J. Trump. We love you.
Love you, Trump. Anyway,
no homo. Moving on.
Blew my mind that I hadn't realized how gigantic the fan reaction was.
You cannot put things on the list because you rewatch them high, because my number one is actually a match that I watched while high. And so it will forever have an added layer of drama that
me.
I cannot.
I'm done with this one anyways. Give it to me.
My number one, it definitely would not be your number one. This may not be my number
Demolition,
one.
Let me be very clear. Demolition versus Colossal Connection is not
is
my
his
number
favorite
one.
Match at WrestleMania of all time. I just want to make that perfectly clear. That's his favorite match of all time. Okay. Not even just at WrestleMania ever. And it's actually his favorite moment of all time, his entire life. He only looks back to the Colossal Connection.
Quit stalling, Ray.
Okay. All right. My number one or my last pick is The Undertaker versus Triple H, Hell in a Cell, part two of their matches.
I thought about this one.
The end of an era match. And so I will say that Shawn Michaels versus Undertaker and Triple H versus Undertaker back to back, I could put all four of those matches on in a row and not be not entertained. That's a double negative, but we're moving back on.
This is another one where I thought Undertaker might lose.
Yeah, this was, I think this was absolutely the drama in this match is on hype level, almost like no other match. And I think the biggest difference maker is not the Hell in a Cell, although Hell in a Cell definitely makes a difference. Seeing things like chair shots that you haven't seen in a while, but the difference maker in this match is Shawn Michaels as a guest referee. And when I complain about Ken Shamrock as the referee, the reason why I do is when you see someone who understands the business like Shawn Michaels does, and you see him as a guest referee, and you see what he brings, like... All right, so JR, as an announcer, he says the goal of an announcer is to put over the talent and the angles. And as a referee, that should be your same goal, is to put over what is happening in that ring. And Shawn Michaels does that in spades. The moment where Triple H tombstones The Undertaker may be the greatest false finish in WrestleMania or possibly history ever. Like, that moment, I legitimately shit my pants. I actually shit my pants. I want to admit this on the podcast that I pooped in my pants a little bit.
I thought I smelled something a little funky there. No, I'm just kidding.
I think that was actually the, yeah, well, we're not going to talk about that, Donald. So, but yes. Just,
I actually marked out for the super kick.
Yeah. Oh, my. Oh, and then followed. Or so was it super kick into Tombstone or was it super kick after?
I don't remember.
I think it might have been super kick into Tombstone into pin.
Okay.
That I think that was the moment.
Okay.
That
I just remember there being a super kick and I was like, wow, they're actually doing it. But it didn't happen.
And it's, you know, that could I would probably retrospectively, I don't know if that's a word, I'll be pissed off at Triple H and end the streak. But it would have been a perfect...
Who else to break the streak than Triple H?
Two right? People that you never bet against.
No. See, I like Triple H. So I like Triple H.
I had a phase with Triple H, and the phase ended, but...
I just... Man, the Lesnar thing is still a bit odd to me.
Yeah, it was... I don't know that it was the best decision
especially
in the world.
Especially now, since they're like not even... You know, it's all about Goldberg, I guess, right now.
Well, we'll keep that for the discussion of...
Yes. We're foreshadowing.
Right.
We're foreshadowing. But let's put a bow on this, take a break, and then...
All right.
And that was it for our favorite matches of all time.
Yeah, you know what? Hit us up on our email or on our social media. And
Twitter.com/JerkOfAllTradesPodcast. We're at JOAT Podcast, Facebook.com, Jerk of All Trades Podcast, SoundCloud. You know, obviously, you're not listening to this without it being on SoundCloud. If we missed anything or, you know, you agree with us, disagree with us, definitely hit us up. We'll definitely let you know how wrong you are and how right we are.
I just found out some of the people that we're following on Twitter, and we might have to have a discussion later on, but. Do we cover the email as well, where they can send us hate mail or fan mail or whatever kind of mail
yes.
that they want to send us?
Yeah, any type of email, definitely hit us up at jerkofalltradespodcast@gmail.com.
Yes, yes, yes. We will be waiting anxiously.
Either Ray or myself will put a star in your email and let you know that we put a star in your email and reply to you as soon as possible.
Alrighty, we are going to break, folks.
Back.
All right, we are back in Jerk of All Trades Podcast, and So we would be remiss, especially if we had a wrestling podcast, if we did not discuss the news of the day.
Breaking news.
As the internets and the 4chans and the Reddits of the world have described it as the greatest night in the history of our sport. Mm-hmm. And also what a time to be alive. So Eddie is not an active watcher of professional wrestling these days, but he knows a bit, and obviously he has a long history in this business and watching, and some actual history in the business. But so what I wanted to show Eddie, and first we will I'm gonna show him just one single picture. And then I will briefly discuss what's been going on, and then he can kind of give me the feedback. So, all right. So
I'm looking forward to this.
All right. So
this has been a teaser the whole time.
All right. So probably one of the biggest women wrestlers of the past, probably 5-6 years or so is Paige. She's big enough that apparently The Rock is making like a big budget movie about her. She was kind of one of the forebearers of the women's revolution that's happened in the past, few years in WWE and, in wrestling in general. And, kind of changing the perception of what women are in this business and, the role that they play and kind of making them more equal with the men. And honestly, she's been a good wrestler, but, what has happened the past couple days now on the internet? It's called the Fappening 3.0. And so in recent years, there's been
there's a Fappening 1.0 and
yes, actually there is a Fappening 1.0 and 2.0. This is the third version of the Fappening, as M. Night Shyamalan would call it. But so basically with the advent of the cloud and the fact that people are putting their information basically in the hands of, someone else instead of just, on their own hard drives, and people that have really nothing better to do with their time than hack people and grab their information and do whatever they want with it. And so last night was definitely the most intense version of the Fappening, in which a number of hardcore pornographic videos of one said Paige leaked onto the internet slowly. There are currently about 6 videos and a good number of pictures, and they are of the very, very intense version. There is one in which she is, putting a large plastic piece into her secondary hole, I guess we will call it. There is a number of other videos in which she is engaging in sexual activities. But definitely most interesting is the fact that they also star 2 other WWE wrestlers, one of them a former wrestler and one of them a current wrestler, both of whom are married as well. The first being Mr. Brad Maddox, who was probably most famous for being a kind of crooked referee during the Ryback CM Punk feud. And then the second one is Mr. Xavier Woods, who is the third man in the New Day. But probably the most interesting aspect of that is that at some point Brad Maddox must have been dating Paige, and there is a video in which Brad Maddox is not only filming Xavier Woods having sex with Paige, but he's actually like on camera close up taking photographs of her being boned by some other dude. That's kind of the long and the short of it. Apparently there are a lot.
So this just came out yesterday?
This just came out yesterday. And in case you did not know, so Brad Maddox has been released from WWE. He is the guy that got released for calling someone a prick on a house show, which is the levels that we made it at.
What a prick.
But Xavier Woods is actually one of the most popular superstars in WWE right now. He's part of the New Day. He has his own, he just that day had a version of his YouTube show, Up, Up, Down, Down with Stephanie McMahon that had over 1 million views on it. And later that day, we would see him laying the bone to Paige while Brad Maddox took close-up pics of his balls.
If The Rock is smart, this is going to be in the movie. It's got to be. It's got to be in the movie.
The speculation is what will happen with the proposed movie that they're making, and will, you know, will this, you know, be in the movie? You know, will
it's
the movie
be
scrapped?
No.
If you saw the photos video, you would assume that it wasn't. But so now I want to show this photo to Mr.
Yes,
Eddie.
He had pictures.
And okay, so preface this in that before Paige was in WWE, she was in NXT, and she was the very first NXT Women's Champion. And it was the start of the, you know, like I said, the women's revolution or whatever it might be called. And, you know, I briefly discussed what that meant to the business. So anyway, I'm going to show you this photo and then you kind of give me your canned reaction to it. This is the last photo that leaked of this. Apparently there is more stuff, but this just leaked and it's probably the most damning of the evidence. So here you go.
Okay, we have the belt here. That's the real belt, right?
This is in fact the belt that she actually held.
What is that? Her thumb?
No, that is actually a man's penis.
Oh damn! Okay.
And that is.
And she's got a face full of stuff. I see.
Yeah, she is. She's got a large amount of milky white substance upon her face and upon this bedazzled title belt. So
oh man, we are not in the PG era anymore. Holy crap. Paige, when's the next time you're coming to Milwaukee or Chicago?
I'm gonna guess it's not anytime soon.
Oh yeah, she's done. I can't imagine what the meeting with her and Vince and Triple H was. if there even was one, they probably just beat the fuck out of her in a dark room.
All right, one more video that you have to see here, or a GIF or a GIF as it's called. this is her handing off the NXT title to John Bradshaw.
So that's
Layfield.
Why she did it. Bradshaw's a fucking asshole, and she wanted to give him the jizz belt.
If any belt deserved to have jizz all over it, was the one that was shaped like a butterfly. But
wait, no, she's keeping the other.
She's keeping the butterfly one. You do not want to know. Well,
God knows what she did with that belt.
We can only
Paige, what happened?
Actually,
girl?
we do not have to imagine.
Somebody hacked her shit.
So yeah, she was actually she was hacked along with a number of other actresses. Emma Watson was actually one that was hacked from the Harry Potter.
So this is like a big thing,
right? So basically, they the 4chaners, the Anonymous, as they are known, they basically hack the shit out of the cloud and they find all of these photos and videos that are put on the cloud and then they. You know, put them out in the world and the FBI tries to shut it down. And, you know, I think we all know that that's not going to work. So
I always wonder what Anonymous thinks of my fucking photos. They're terrible.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, this fucking nerd.
I think
fucking shitty pictures.
I really think it's an interesting, you know, just aside from the whole wrestling aspect of it. But I think it's very interesting that this is almost. The power of the internet has really kind of started to give power back to, you know, the individual, and not just the individual, but the individual, you know, combined with a bunch of like-minded individuals. And it's almost a reactionary type of thing to the celebrity worship culture that we live in, and kind of bringing these people back down to reality. And it's interesting to see these people, you know, for what they are. I mean, they're just people. They like sticking dildos in their butt, and they like getting, you know, cucked in, you know, their apartment loft and stuff.
In all seriousness, this is bad news for Paige. Clearly, she was about to have big things happening for her.
I mean, she did. I mean, she's been one of the, you know, the biggest female stars, you know, the past few years, and it's hard to think that, you know, she's not going to see her career kind of go kaput from this. So.
Well, you never know. Good old Hooker Kardashian with Sky. She got shot to the moon after her fucking sex tape came out.
Yeah, you know what? I will tell you that.
This might be the best thing for
you. You know, might put that to shame, but, you know, it's not
it's for
me.
It's hard to say. Well, she's done in WWE for sure.
Yeah, in this era, probably. In the Attitude era, all I can say is, you know, the 16-year-old me is probably pretty upset.
If they won't let Hulk Hogan back in, they're not letting her back.
Oh, they're going to let Hulk Hogan back in, for sure. And here's the thing, too, that, you know, the no publicity is bad publicity thing. In the moment right now, this is probably pretty bad for her, but, you know, let's look, you know.
What if they scrap the movie, though?
It's possible.
She's done in Hollywood and she's done in wrestling. WWE.
It is definitely possible, but I mean, there's a lot of investment in her already. And here's the thing. More people care about her and know her than they did before.
Yeah.
So in the end, I mean, it's not looking very good for her.
We'll
you know,
have to see what happens.
Or depending on what your preference is, it might be looking better for her. But
I think she looks a lot better. No.
Yeah, that title belt is very fitting.
Thing,
it gleams in her eye.
I knew nothing about Paige before this.
And now you know.
And now I know who Paige is.
Right.
Right. So,
and, you know, who knows?
Okay.
You might even know more about her, you know, down the line.
Yeah,
so.
As time goes on. Yeah.
So.
Cool. Interesting. Yeah. I mean, I really don't have much to say about that.
I just think it's an interesting, you know, like you look at that from, you know, the perspective of, you know, whatever, take a different era and imagine, like, you know, a video of Trish Stratus getting, you know, laid down by Farouk while, you know, Midian jerked off in the background would probably be an interesting visual. So those are the best people that I could come up with at the time. I don't know.
I was about to say your placement of 90s wrestlers there was pretty good.
And I probably could have picked like Chris Jericho or something. I don't know. Actually, Brad Maddox is not a Jericho.
I was going to say is Trish Stratus is way too good for Midian.
Yeah, probably. But you know
way
what? You
too
don't,
good for Midian.
You don't know. You
with
don't.
All due respect to Midian and everything, but Trish
yeah,
Stratus
you know what, Midian? If you've got then, if you've got your own woo! Podcast. You know what?
No. I'm not talking to Midian. I'm talking to Trish Stratus.
Okay.
Right
all
now.
Right.
Oh, baby.
Trish, if you've got your own podcast, you know what?
No. Trish, come be on our podcast.
Yeah.
Please.
Come and join us.
Like, I just want to ask you a couple questions.
I swear. That's yeah. He does not have ether on a rag, I swear. Nope. Yeah. Don't even worry about it. You're totally good.
Anyways. So, transitioning over to the current day product.
That's a transition noise.
Okay, cool.
Just kidding. It will never be the transition noise. We're not worthy.
The whole reason we did this podcast is because of WrestleMania. WrestleMania 33. I'm not sure what day it is again.
April 3rd, April 2nd,
okay,
maybe.
So that's like 2 weeks.
I don't know. Let's confirm what the... it is actually April 2nd. April 2nd, 2017. WrestleMania
33. We got all the matches lined up on Wikipedia because that's how we roll.
Wiki. All right. Let's see. Where do
probably start from the bottom.
So yeah. Well, I mean, we don't. Let's skip that one because we really don't.
Oh, I already got a prediction for that one.
All right. So I think we can probably skip the Battle Royal because.
Oh. Yeah.
Yeah. No one knows. Quite exactly who's going to be in that.
Big Show.
Big Show is a good choice. Yeah, I'm not going to make a call on that.
Isn't Big Show wrestling Shaquille O'Neal?
Actually, no. Apparently, there's some sort of thing where Shaquille O'Neal is like not in shape or something, and so Big Show can't wrestle him. So I can't say I'm all that
great.
Upset about it.
Damn it.
So, yeah, it's going to be pretty upsetting.
Oh, well.
All right, so let's start off. Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson. The club, I don't know if they're still called that, versus Enzo Amore, Big Cass, and versus Cesaro and Sheamus. First match. Also, keep in mind, before we do the predictions, I mentioned a couple times, Eddie is not an active watcher. He doesn't He knows a bit of the shows. I force feed it to him.
John Cena. Yes. Absolutely.
Change my cadence there, but
he better be the main event. That's all I'm saying. All
right. So you barely know any of these people. Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson. Luke Gallows was Festus, a while back.
Okay. But
Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson, they were in New Japan. They were with AJ Styles and the Bullet Club. They've been really poorly utilized. But anyway, that's
they're facing Sheamus and
versus Enzo Amore and Big Cass. Enzo Amore is the dude with like the cheetah hair who's like, you know, dancing around.
Yeah,
and the tall guy.
Yeah.
Probably the best comedic mic worker these days.
He's a breath of fresh air.
And Cesaro and Sheamus. A three-way match.
See, who does Vince like the most out of these three guys? Or six guys, I should say. I'm definitely not going with the champions because WrestleMania is a big show, and at a big show, you need title changes.
Actually, more times than not, the title in a world title match at WrestleMania has not changed hands.
Bro.
I forgot I saw what the numbers were on that before, but this is a tag match.
I'm going with Sheamus and Cesaro because Sheamus is cool.
All right. You know what? Actually, interestingly, I just watched a podcast. I did not watch a podcast. That is not possible.
You can. It's on YouTube.
That's true.
Rogan has his podcast.
I actually did recently watch a podcast, but anyway, I actually recently watched a documentary, and it was about the life of Vampiro, who I'm also a big fan of. I was from about 2009, and I thought it was interesting. He was kind of starting his own promotion. And he was running a show in Ireland, and there was a young Sheamus there, and it was interesting watching Sheamus talking about, you know, all his career aspirations and all these kind of hopes and stuff he would have for the business. And he had hoped that at one point he would be in a low card match at WrestleMania for the tag titles that he wouldn't win. So, he actually didn't say that, but that would be
really
some sort of weird, sickening foresight that
yeah, that's an awesome
didn't have.
Premonition for sure.
But
who's your pick?
So my pick would probably be Enzo and Big Cass. They have not had the belts. They're the only guys out of these three teams that have not had the tag titles, and I think this would be probably a good spot for them to win the belts. I think the end game on Enzo and Big Cass has to be Big Cass being a singles guy. He's a big, tall dude, and Vince likes big, tall dudes. So, this will give them a chance to kind of do their tag thing or whatever, and then, eventually break up. But, Enzo and Big Cass, that's my call.
Cool. You're wrong, but cool.
Yeah, I once again, you know what? I had my best prediction years in the years I was not watching, so.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens. Who's next?
All right. Next match is going to be Neville versus Austin Aries for the Cruiserweight Championship.
Oh god. Who's the champ?
Neville is currently the champion. And you know who both guys are.
I know Austin Aries a little bit. All right, was in ECW, right?
No. Austin Aries was he's from Milwaukee. He was in TNA for a long time. He's
not the guy that did the flipping pile driver?
No, that's PD Williams.
Oh.
Austin Aries. Here, I'll show you a picture of him. Sorry, this is probably bad podcasting here.
So, I'll already give you my pick. I picked a title change in the first title match. I will be picking a title defense in the second title match. I will be going with a champion on this one. I think he defends, and he's a heel, right?
Neville is a heel.
Okay. Yeah, I don't remember him too good.
He's actually pretty badass.
I remember his name. If I seen him wrestle,
I'm pretty happy that he's like one of those like indie guys that's been around forever and like never ever got a chance to go to WWE like he did for a little bit.
Well, he was in TNA though.
Right. I mean, you know, fucking
that's not
my
bad.
My fucking, you know,
not like being in WCW. But
my fucking pet turtle was in TNA. It doesn't, you know,
Trying to get some of that WCW money.
Don't actually have a pet turtle, but yeah.
Bring back WCW, goddammit.
Yeah, I wouldn't complain about that. Yeah, so for my pick, you know, actually initially I was going to pick Austin Aries, but I feel like a Neville title defense at WrestleMania, you know, maybe even in kind of shady circumstances, would give this feud a little bit of legs to stand on for a little bit longer. The cruiserweight division doesn't have a lot more going on for it. So yeah, I'm gonna go with Neville. All right, next match is for the SmackDown Women's Championship. Alexa Bliss versus Carmella, with James Ellsworth versus Natalya versus Mickie James versus Becky Lynch versus other people of the female persuasion.
Wait, okay, so it's a 8-man?
It's a bunch of ladies from SmackDown facing on off against each other and fighting for their women's title belt. And Alexa Bliss, she's the champion. Carmella and Natalya, who is Jim Neidhart's daughter. Mickey James, I assume you remember Mickey James.
Mickey James is the only one I know Natalya.
And Becky Lynch, who is the chick with the orange hair.
So I have a theory in this match. Which one is the hottest? I know it's subjective.
Mickey James, maybe, or Becky Lynch.
I guarantee the hottest chick will win this match. I don't know which one it is, but
well, you know what? I would almost. This is almost where I would argue about the women's revolution and how women are not the same objects that they used to be. But then, you know, one of the biggest stars, you know, got come on while she had her belt, you know, in front of her face. So
it can't be that big. I don't know. I never even heard of.
Well,
that.
I mean. Yeah,
but I mean, you did say she had a reality show, right?
She's on Total Divas or whatever the fuck it's called.
But yeah, I mean, whoever the hottest chick is, if I could see the pictures, I could tell you who would win this one. But
do you want to see the pictures?
Not really.
Okay, all right.
The hottest chick will win. That's my pick. Who's your pick?
My pick is fuck. Becky Lynch, I guess.
It's a tough one. There's a lot of different choices.
Yeah.
I'm surprised you're not going with Mickey James.
Yeah, I was considering it, but she's like, you know, she's, you know, from a previous generation, and I don't think they're going to give her a WrestleMania victory. So.
She deserves it the most.
Yeah, she does. I met her at a local wrestling event recently, and so I was pretty happy to see that she got signed and such. So, yeah,
well, you know what that means.
Actually, good friends.
If she deserves it the most, she's not going to get it.
This is true. This is true.
When is the Shane McMahon match?
I'm going to wait until I'm past all the other matches I don't care as much about.
Okay. I thought you were just going to completely...
No. All right. This is for the Raw Women's Championship. Bayley.
Oh, great.
Versus Charlotte Flair versus Sasha Banks.
Bayley versus Charlotte Flair versus Sasha Banks. Just three of them, right?
Correct. Yep, triple threat match.
Okay. Charlotte Flair as
wait, do you want to hear, would you like to hear any of the angle that's been going on? Do you think that would help or hinder
you?
No,
that's gonna hurt me.
Okay.
Charlotte Flair is Ric Flair's daughter, I'm assuming.
Correct.
That's my pick.
Okay. All right. So knowing the backstory of this, basically they're 100% telegraphing the fact that Sasha Banks is going to turn heel on Bayley. Bayley basically won the belt because of Sasha.
Oh!
And Sasha has been...
I know Bayley.
Yeah, she's the hugger.
Yeah, she's got the big things.
The flaily things. Yeah. So she's like the ultimate good, you know, good guy, good girl, whatever. And
so she should win.
So she won her belt and has won all of her title defenses because Sasha Banks has interfered for her. And so they're definitely telegraphing the fact that Sasha's going to somehow turn on Bayley. So I'm going to guess that somehow Sasha comes out of this match with the title because of that turn.
Ooh, you're going deep. So. Damn. It makes me rethink my pick, but I gotta go Flair.
It's tough though because they might fuck that up too, and they would be like, "Well, Sasha turns on Bayley, but she still doesn't win the belt, and somehow like, you know."
You gotta be fair to Flair.
Sometimes you spend too much time thinking about it, and yeah. So
gotta be fair to Flair. I'm going Flair all the
way. But I gotta think logically, and I gotta
the
say
Flairs
Sasha.
Have a knack for getting the gold.
Yeah.
And the biggest stage.
All right. Next match is the match that you were probably not hoping that he ended up in, but Mr. John Cena.
Yeah. Versus.
And his girlfriend, Nikki Bella.
Versus.
In a mixed tag match. The Miz and his wife Maryse. That is the match. You gotta pick it.
Oh, what happened here?
I told you, dude. I told you he was gonna end up in a mixed tag match, and you were not. And there
you
he
did
is.
Say that,
I did say that, yeah. And here he is.
Fuck, I'm going John Cena all day. But
yeah,
damn it, man.
I mean, I think John Cena is definitely gonna win this match.
Yeah,
and his girl.
But. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, you know what? This is one that like. All right, so I don't completely understand it, but when you understand that there are people that don't watch wrestling that may see WrestleMania that may only know about it because of Total Divas, this is that match. This is the match that appeals to that demo of person that...
This is the Total Divas match.
This is literally the Total Divas match.
Oh, God. John Cena went from greatest superstar of all time to the Total Divas.
But when you consider that Total Divas probably has more viewership than Monday Night Raw does. Actually, I don't know if that's
really?
True, but...
It probably does.
I mean,
nowadays.
in a different demo as well, you know? Like, who watches...
So they need John Cena.
Right. Who watches pro wrestling and who watches Total Divas? There's probably not a strong overlap. You know, I could sit here and spout off a million different wrestling facts. I have never watched more than 1 minute of Total Divas in my entire life, and I never will. But I guarantee you that there are, you know, ladies and, you know, probably dudes that watch the E! Entertainment Network and watch Total Divas. That's not me.
Yeah, I don't get it.
But they may enjoy this match. So,
man.
But in the end, John Cena is going to fucking...
He better get cheered.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
He's not.
It's about time.
It's possible, man.
Who's he wrestling against?
The Miz and his wife Maryse
and the Miz. Oh God, he's definitely gonna get cheered. I'm going out on a limb here. He's definitely getting cheered.
Is that bonus points?
I should get a half a point for that.
All right, I'll give you a half a point.
Yeah.
All right. Next match is we'll finally go with your match. Shane McMahon versus AJ Styles.
This is an easy pick for me. I've always been a big Shane McMahon fan, not really big, but big enough. And he always does the good deed at WrestleMania. He puts over the talent, so I'm going AJ Styles all the way.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt. I'm so glad. I was hoping that you didn't try to go against the grain and say that somehow Shane was going to win this match because he's not winning this fucking match. And he better not, because you know what? AJ Styles had... probably the best year of any modern WWE guy, and especially the best first year ever. Pretty much every best match of 2016 involves AJ Styles. So he deserves to have a WrestleMania where he at least gets the Duke. He did not get it last year against Jericho, so he deserves to at least get that. It's... not surprising, we've talked about this before, that, you know, come WrestleMania time, AJ Styles, Kevin Owens, not in the title matches. Not shocking, but at the very least, AJ deserves to beat Shane McMahon, and he will. So
I don't remember Jericho versus AJ.
It was all right. It wasn't on the list of best AJ Styles matches.
Who was the main event last year?
That was the match where I think we all collectively fell asleep. Roman Reigns versus Triple H.
I don't think I watched that one last year.
It's pretty bad.
Yeah,
pretty bad.
Yeah, I'll pass.
All right. Moving on to the next match. Chris Jericho, the U.S. champion, versus Kevin Owens. Do you know any of the backstory and what has happened with this?
You know, when I was on injury leave, I did get to see a couple Raws with Jericho and Kevin Owens. So I do know a tiny bit about this. I didn't see where they split, but I knew they were a tag team.
Yeah,
or
they
not a tag team, but like they would come out together. So Jericho's defending.
So basically, Kevin Owens had the Universal title, which was the Raw equivalent of the world title. And Jericho was always helping him win his matches. And, you know, kind of secretively, Kevin Owens was not appreciating that because he felt, you know, he was good enough on his own. And anyway, in the end, Kevin Owens turned on Chris Jericho and beat the ever-living poo-poo out of him on Monday Night Raw in the Festival of Friendship, as it was called.
Aw, shit.
And so that's an inside joke for those that aren't on the in. When Kevin Owens defended his Universal title against Goldberg at the most recent pay-per-view Fastlane, Chris Jericho came out. Well, you know, he came out and his music played, and Kevin Owens ended up getting speared and jackhammered. Not quite like Paige got speared and jackhammered, but that's for another day. But he lost the title, and so thus we are at this match now, where Chris Jericho has the U.S. title basically because Kevin Owens helped him win the title. So
I'm going Owens here. Jericho's the champ, right?
Jericho is the champion, yes.
Yeah, I see a title change. Owens, the younger guy. And Jericho seems to be pretty good about, or not pretty good about it, like it's his choice. But the WWE company seems to be pretty good about letting Jericho job out at WrestleMania frequently. So,
yeah, you know what? I cannot disagree with that. I think that Chris Jericho is supposedly going to be leaving at the end of April again for a while to go do his band thing. So I think there's probably no doubt in my mind that Kevin Owens is going to win this match. And I mean, I don't think he really needs a U.S. title, but, you know, he's going to probably get it. And so it should be a good match. I think that both guys will bring their best at WrestleMania. And it's nice that at least Kevin Owens gets to be in a high profile match at WrestleMania. So,
yeah, we'll see what happens. Should be a good match.
All right, so we've got the big three matches coming up here to talk about, but we're going to take another quick break, and then we will come back, and we will discuss those matches, and then we will do a little wrap-up for the first episode of Jerk of All Trades podcast. So we'll be right back, guys. We are back, Jerk of All Trades podcast, the very first, the intro episode to the podcast. I know that this has been a wrestling-centric podcast, and once again, keep in mind, guys, this is not what the whole podcast is going to be. We just thought that this would be a good starting point to, you know, kind of talk about whatever brought us together and what, you know, we realized that we got along in being total, you know, jerkwad, sarcastic fools. And so yeah, we'll be covering a lot of interesting, you know, current events and topics and such. So
if you made it this far, we know you truly love us.
Yes, you and if you don't love us, you're gonna love us. And we are outside of your window right now, and we're gonna make damn good and sure that you do. So
you'll come back and listen to this later when we're big and awesome.
You did not hear the actual words that were spoken in the reverse wording that I spoke earlier. So yeah, I'm not gonna talk more about that. Let's go to the top three, the big three for
big three, WrestleMania 33,
the big three, the biggest matches on the show. Let's discuss those and see what we think is going to happen. So, the Undertaker is going to be taking on Mr. Roman Reigns at WrestleMania this year. What's going to happen?
Wow.
It's actually interesting because you were not aware that this is a match.
No, I did not know at all. This is interesting because Roman Reigns is like the, I don't know how to describe him.
The most hated man in the entire world would probably be.
Well, he's like the new guy, but nobody likes him.
Right.
He's kind of like John Cena in a way.
Right, but he's like John Cena, but really no one likes him. And a cat is stepping on a keyboard, so please move.
We have to spritz him.
Let's
see. Man, this is a tough one to call, huh? I'm going Undertaker just because.
Man, this is a very, very tough match to call. So the story, in case you care. So basically, Roman Reigns, as you probably know, or you may not know, is probably the most hated man in professional wrestling, despite the fact that he's a good guy. Because he is being forced as the next big thing, and nobody really thinks that is what he is. But yeah, they keep on keeping on with it. And so, yeah, at the Royal Rumble this year, he came out at number 30 when people expected a big surprise, and instead they got him after he lost his title match. So there was no good goddamn reason why he should have been in this match, because he could have won the title, and then he could have been number 30, and then he would have won a shot against himself. And we would have watched Roman Reigns jerk off in the ring, probably. Well, being with the Paige video, you never know.
Exactly.
stranger things have actually happened. So, he ended up coming out at number 30, and he ended up eliminating The Undertaker and had some choice words for The Undertaker, in which he told him that it was his yard now. And then they completely ignored that for a while, where The Undertaker sat at home and collected money. And eventually The Undertaker came out. And now they're going to face each other at WrestleMania. So a little backstory. But my take on this match is, if you're going to turn Roman Reigns heel, what a better way to do it than at WrestleMania against The Undertaker? You know, if the streak was on the line, even bigger. But, you know, have Roman Reigns cheat to win this match. Have him do something dastardly and shitty to beat The Undertaker, and you've got your top heel. Why would you not do that? I can't wait to, you know, watch or listen to this retroactively and or think of the thoughts that were in my brain at this point and realize that they were never going to happen, and we're going to be seeing Roman Reigns beat The Undertaker fair and square for no apparent goddamn reason. But I'm going to go with Roman Reigns because I see no reason why The Undertaker needs to beat Roman Reigns. That's my take.
This is probably the toughest one to call out of all of them, really. The Undertaker one usually is the easiest one, but now that he has already lost, makes it a little different.
What
you went Undertaker, right?
No,
you went Reigns.
I went Reigns, dude. Reigns.
I could have sworn I heard you say Undertaker.
No. Roman Reigns is going to win because I think he's going to turn heel. He's going to turn heel and he's going to cheat to win.
Okay. Yeah. Oof, man. I mean, at this point, there's been so many Undertaker matches, it doesn't really matter that much. But it's hard to bet against him.
Yeah. You know, you're not wrong. I think it would be, you know, a perfect scenario in which The Undertaker just wins and nothing big happens, but... Yeah, somehow I think that...
there's a way for Reigns to look good in defeat.
Roman Reigns, after he popped on a wellness policy violation when he had the title, and they jobbed him out clean to Seth Rollins at one of the pay-per-views. So, I mean, there's no reason why he can't just straight up lose to The Undertaker, but I don't really see the benefit of it. You know, aside, I will say that at times that they, you know, just have things happen just at WrestleMania just to happen there. And there's no real good rhyme or reason beyond that. But I think the most logical thing is for Roman Reigns to win this match and to, become a heel somehow. So
this is probably my most anticipated match.
Yeah, I think it's going to be interesting. You know what? Despite all the hate that he gets, I think Roman Reigns is his matches are always, you know, looked forward to, and they're always interesting. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to this match, no doubt. All right, moving on to the Raw main event. I guess we don't actually know what the layout of the pay-per-view is going to be, but the champion, Mr. Bill Goldberg, is going to be defending his Universal title against Mr. Brock Lesnar. Yes. In a repeat of probably the... the most disappointing, or I don't know if I'll say most disappointing, but one of the most least underwhelming WrestleMania matches of all time. And for some reason, they've decided to go back to that. I guess they have better circumstances this time. But Goldberg versus Brock Lesnar, what's going to happen?
Well, my take on it is Goldberg owes Lesnar the favor. I don't know if Goldberg's going to stick around. I have no idea. Apparently, Lesnar's still in it for a while, right?
Yeah, I believe so. I believe he's got a long-term contract. So.
Okay, so it's Lesnar's turn. He gets the win. He gets the belt. He gets all the good stuff that comes along with it. So I just think that Goldberg's not going to stick around, and it's Brock's turn. You know, Brock did the favor first, and now it's Goldberg's turn to do the favor for Brock.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. I mean, Goldberg... just absolutely destroyed Brock. He won the last match. I think there's no reason why Goldberg is winning this match. Apparently, you know, Goldberg's last night is WrestleMania. He may sign a longer term contract intermediately, but yeah, I think he's losing this match. He's gonna put Brock over. There's no reason to think otherwise.
About damn time. Brock got fucking that Royal Rumble. Left a sour taste in my mouth with him just, you know, clearing the ring and then Goldberg just getting rid of him.
And the and the Survivor Series where he got defeated in like 43 seconds. So
I didn't see that.
I thought we watched it.
No, not Survivor Series.
Oh yeah,
but
it's not much to watch.
I believe the
Paige leaked videos actually are longer than the Goldberg. versus Brock Lesnar Survivor Series match. So, there's not as much spearing in the Goldberg versus Brock Lesnar matches as well. So, and I believe there is more jackhammering in the Paige videos too.
The first thing I'm
doing
after we record this is watching that fucking video. It can't be as good as hyped.
Good luck. The FBI has actually swooped in and they've eliminated all of the leaks. So, you have to go onto the Fort to the Chan to try to find new thread with it, but yeah.
It'll come out again eventually.
Yeah, it may come out again all over the NXT women's title. So, all right, that was that may or may not be the last Paige semen sex tape.
Oh man, you're on fire with the Paige right now.
Joke of the night. So we'll see. We only have a limited amount of time. We only have one more match and the wrap up. So you know. I don't believe that Paige or either one of her participants wrapped up for their sex tape video. So, all right, moving on to the last match of the card is going to be for the SmackDown WWE Championship is Mr. Bray Wyatt. I don't know why I call everyone Mr., but, you know, they're younger than me. So Bray Wyatt is going to be facing off against not Mr. Randy Orton, but the one and only Randy Orton. For the WWE Championship. What's going to happen here?
Finger Poke of Doom Part 2. I think Bray Wyatt. Oh, no, wait.
Once again, do you want to know the storyline behind this match?
I know a little bit about it. I saw one of the SmackDowns while I was on. I was chilling at the house. But I think one of them is going to take the Finger Poke and...
I believe Paige actually took a finger poke as well.
Yeah.
Amongst other things.
You know, one of them's going to take an easy night. Or actually, both of them probably take an easy night. But, I have no idea how this is going to...
You know who else took an easy night?
Xavier Woods? Brad Maddox. Brad Maddox.
Yeah, actually, the answer was Brad Maddox.
Yeah. All right. I don't know.
So
I'm going with Bray Wyatt because of the finger poke.
All right, so Eddie is taking Bray. So basically, the storyline behind this is, you know, Bray and Randy Orton were, you know, Randy became his lemming in the Wyatt family, whatever, whatever, and eventually Randy Orton turned on Bray Wyatt and burned his complex to the ground. And so I can't imagine finger poke.
Oh, so they're not friends
anymore? No, no. Randy Orton burned Bray Wyatt's, you know, whatever home dwelling thing that he must, you know, go to.
Well, that changes my pick.
That's what I was trying to tell you before. So I can't imagine finger poke of doom is going to probably be what happens. I'm gonna stick with Bray somehow. I'm gonna stick with Bray somehow. Keeps the belt here because, I mean, this is Bray's first title victory, and I feel like they could probably stretch this out a little bit longer as well. So, Bray Wyatt.
Yeah, Eddie the Jerk is making his pick officially. Randy Orton.
You know, and not a bad call. And I'm going against the grain and not picking Randy Orton because all signs point to Randy Orton is fucking winning this match. But I'm gonna say that somehow, some way, Bray Wyatt manages to keep this title for right now. Although he will lose. He will definitely lose to Randy Orton in the end. But that's my call.
Time will tell, my friend. 2 weeks away.
Time will tell.
2 weeks away, our picks are in, and this podcast is in.
The podcast is in. We
first one down.
WrestleMania 33 talked about greatest WrestleMania matches of all time, greatest leaked sex videos of WWE women wrestlers and divas of all time talked about. We
hope you enjoyed it.
Some fun, what do the kids say? The banter and,
Oh yes. Yes, indeed. Stay tuned for more banter, shenanigans and tomfoolery. We'll have more stuff in store for you, to keep you on your toes, to make things more interesting or not more interesting, but interesting enough. If you didn't like wrestling, we'll have some more different stuff for you. This was just more wrestling centric for WrestleMania coming up. And we'll have all bunch of different stuff to talk about. Should be fun, good times. Don't take us too seriously. You know, we're going to talk a lot of shit, and hopefully you enjoy it.
You better believe it. Jerk of All Trades Podcast. Why don't you hit them up again with the social media?
Yes, indeed. Facebook.com, Jerk of All Trades. Twitter.com, @JOAT Podcast. JerkOfAllTrades@gmail.com and SoundCloud.com/JerkOfAllTrades. And we're open to conversation, so just hit us up, and you know, we appreciate you guys taking the time out to hear us out.
Absolutely, yeah. And tell us what you think, man. Tell us, did you love it? Did you hate it? Did you love hate it? Did you hate love it? You know.
Did you enjoy Paige? Because I didn't get to see it.
And if you have not seen the videos, you should see them, and then the context of the comedy will be improved. So then you will go back and you will re-listen to the podcast, and you will appreciate the humor in a different light.
Yeah, fucking Paige.
Maybe you will. Maybe you won't. Yeah, from what I've heard, many people have. So, all right, guys, we'll see you next week. Jerk of All Trades Podcast. We are out.
Yes.